But, you know, kept Echo too by switching him up top lane, and it's kind of, all the pieces have kind of fallen into place for them.
So we see HiZ put to the ban list right off the bat here as we get into picks and bans going in. It's been a Nasus jungle and I believe an Elise jungle coming out here. Or no, Elise Sin that Meteos has played. So yeah. He's always hard to ban out on that. But you know who's also been hard to ban out is Maple Street. He's yeah. played so many different AD carries this summer split.
Yeah, he's a pretty versatile AD carry. And one of the main ones was Draven, which has got you know, his passive change.
Little,
so we're probably
little balance.
This is one of the first times where I'm not expecting a Draven ban versus Maple Street. But I am interested to see if Cloud9 actually go after Vile Rose and try and ban him fully out. They've already taken the Shen. They could go and ban out that Rumble, even though that is one of Ball's favorite champions. Velocity hat first
pick. If it's up, they'll grab it. He's more than happy to get Shen. Kale's out, so I'm figuring they'll try to pick the Ryze if Vile doesn't hear. And they get Echo's TF, so if they grab Ryze, that makes that pool even more shallow for Vile Rose.
Yeah, they've made Velocity have to choose between Echo's go-to mid laner, which is Twisted Fate, and Vile Rose would love to play Rumble. He played Rumble even in the mid lane Vile Rose was a mid laner. So if they were able to get that from him, not only could they take it away from Balls, but they would also make Vile Rose more comfortable. So it's a hard decision here for Velocity because they only get one pick, and they do go
with
that.
A smile coming out. Vile says, you have your TF. Uh-huh. Make things happen. We see the team communicating. Now, Ball says, hey, guys, my Rumble's open. Do what you want to do. We'll see if he actually goes through with it, though.
And that's interesting because they set this up by banning the other two main champions of Vile Rose. So if they do take away that Rumble, then he's going to be forced onto sort of a third-tier champion there for him. And Cloud9 could very well focus on Vile Rose as the weak point for Velocity and try and get their early advantage in that lane.
It's been done a few times, right? We mm-hmm. saw it happen to Vile, as we stated in the opening part of the show. In that one game, he was down a good 30-40 CS and was still able to come back because of the stand United, which won't be in the game. So we'll have to see if he can still make that comeback on a champion that won't be as easy just to be utility with.
Yeah, I'm interested to see
just how
deep the rabbit hole goes for Vile Rose. But we did have the obvious lock-ins there for Cloud9 taking that Rumble. We've seen Balls perform so well on it, and giving the Kennen over to Hive for the mid lane is something that he's also extremely comfortable with. He loves going the early AD Kennen and bullying that mid lane.
So none of the, so far, double AD comps that we've been seeing all the time coming out here, but possibly the double APs for both sides. And we've seen Twisted Fate in the top lane on Kiwi Kid. We've seen them go through this. Echo is hovering over Ahri, which he also plays as one of his top main mids. So.
Yeah,
they may try something tricky.
If they did, I would definitely still put Twisted Fate in the mid lane because then you have the option of ganking either bottom lane or top lane as soon as you hit level 6. And Zyra is actually one of the mid laners that Vile Rose used to play. So that could either be a support Zyra, which we've seen as the most popular choice, or it could be a solo lane Zyra, which is extremely dangerous to play. Because in a long lane, she has no dashes or gap closers or escapes or anything. Just relies on very good vision coverage and her flash, basically.
And Kobe, this is the wild card they were talking about. Where's that Zyra going? Lemonation said these guys are going to be difficult in champion select. Sneaky said they pick what they pick, and it is what it is.
And the Jarvan, though, that one's definitely shining out to me. It's going to be Ank Ank, and that's usually the player on Velocity that causes people the most scariness. Like, they don't know what he's going to do, and he's usually like the playmaker here for Velocity. So it's actually going to be a very dangerous early game with Jarvan coming from the jungle and Twisted Fate, as soon as he does hit level 6, being able to threaten either the top or the bottom.
Interesting to see Meteos get his pick this late. I remember the first game that they played, Chris actually took Jarvan to the top lane, maybe to take away from Meteos. Meteos played Zac in all 5 games of their opening week, so not really anything pointed directly at him, but an odd pick for him to go last this time.
Yeah, I mean, you pointed it out. Zac is still up, obviously, and that's one of his favorite ones. They did ban out the Elise, but Zac would actually work really well with this Cloud9 team because they've already got the double AP giant AoE ultimates, and having him cause chaos in the back line would just further that. The only thing that's a little bit different for Cloud9 this time around is that they've used Thresh instead of Zyra. The last 4 games, they've had the Zyra and Ashe combo for their duo lane, and it's been just so effective because of the CC. Thresh has a similar amount, just not quite as much as Zyra.
They bring the right amount of crowd control. We've heard some of the people saying, you know, Zac doesn't have the best pre-6 initiations. That soft hit, right, and you get out. But Meteos right now sits in the lead KDA of 10-7-6 to himself. So he's definitely making an impact with whatever jungler he gets.
Yeah, and Zac is one of his favorites because he's of the North American LCS junglers. He is the one most focused on farming the jungle or coming into lanes and farming the lanes. So he gets that elastic slingshot skilled up very quickly. And that's the reason that Zac's early ganks aren't that good, by the way, is because the early levels of your elastic slingshot are very short. The range increases with every point that you put into that skill. So it's not until he gets a couple levels in that he becomes as dangerous as possible. But since Meteos just farms, perfect.
You know, Kobe, something we have to talk about now that Lemon Nation has been putting, you know, on a pedestal is that Ashe Zyra, which was taken away because Zyra's picked over onto Velocity's side. So they kind of tried to disrupt what has really gotten that Cloud9 train going these past few games. Maybe it'll work for that AD lane because Sneaky has been coming out very strong from the laning phase.
Yeah, but because so much emphasis has been put on Zyra for Cloud9 in the past four or five games, that sort of tricked Velocity, I guess.
A little bit of focus
into letting them have Thresh.
Right.
Which historically has been top 1-2 every single game for support. So I don't think that Cloud9 are too disappointed with the switch up of supports here.
You know, one of my favorite things I always read when I was looking up stuff on all the Korean teams is they try to play so they don't have any tendencies. Because how hard is it to play against somebody you don't know what the tendencies are? But sometimes showing those tendencies over and over can give you that trick.
You can trick people, right? It's a mind game. It's kind of like how, what was it, the Koreans talking about Kennen. They weren't even planning on using him. They just tried to bait China into a ban.
And Ambition's like, I like this guy. I think I'll learn it.
Yeah.
So here we are. First game here into week 7, Cloud9 versus Velocity. And these guys coming off of a week 6, 2-0 wins for both. So we'll see if they can keep that momentum going here. Game has begun in the Rift.
So it's probably going to be Vile Rose in the long lane up top here. Thinking that Sneaky is going to be going up there. So it'll be a 2-1 lane probably for both of them here as we see mirrored blue invades just for ward coverage. You know, I have to think, though, Balls is such a strong top laner. He's so confident. Don't think he would be sad going up against Vile Rose. Pretty sure he'd be happy with that one, even though it is Renekton, who is one of the – he's a simpler top champion to play, and he's very strong, too.
I think when you ask most of the top laners, they say, I want the 1v1 fight, especially like somebody like Nick Wu, who's like, I am a fighting person, like fighting game champion. So that's how you just want it. And most of them will say they want to be able to fight instead of just sit there in a 2v1. We'll see how they pan out on this. It looks like it will be Renekton going topside, and he's going to meet up with that Sneaky and Lemon Nation. So the 2v1s are engaged.
Yeah, that was initially what I thought. But one of the main things that guarantees one of the switches for Cloud9 is those double side invades. They put the wards down to not only get vision of where the jungler is going and where the jungler is going to start, but that also lets you pick exactly the starting lanes that you want. So they were able to get that 2-1 with Sneaky and Lemon Nation.
Let's see what wards have actually been placed. A lot of focus put down on the safety of that Twisted Fate in middle. So Echo is looking to stay extra safe. A grab onto Vile Rose. Some early harass there. And this is going to be, you know, history repeats itself for these 2v1 laners in the beginning. They don't get much of the first or second wave, but then they start getting help from the junglers.
But with having Balls on Rumble, I mean, as long as he's able to get that level 6, then they will have the potential to use that Rumble ultimate, especially since he's already in the bottom lane, to go for an early dragon. So what we could see in the early stages is if Sneaky and Lemon Nation can time their top tower push and back just in time for the Balls level 6, then they can transition very easily from a top tower kill into a dragon down on the bottom side of the map.
NK Inc. presence a little early here towards the top lane, and he doesn't try to get over the wall. It looks like he's just making sure that he won't get countered as he gets up to this lane. So the save 2v1 soak up, or 2v2 soak up, I should say.
Yeah, we've already seen the difference in junglers there. Meteos is up one camp now. He's taken the Wolves' small camp, whereas NK immediately rushing to his solo laner's aid.
So Meteos, again, we'll pay attention as well, because we say it a lot and we don't see him too much doing it. We just see it in the CS, that he takes more of the CS than most of the, you know, the 80 carry being in lane and Watt. So we'll see if he does soak that up. Right now it's going to be him in the bottom lane. Jarvan going in, NK Inc. just trying to show some aggression and pressure them off of the turret. You can see there, Meteos' picks with Zach four times, 100%. It's not bad at all.
You pretty much can't get better than that, Riv. 100% is as good as you can hope for, and they've got plenty of AoE down there to defend these waves. Lemon takes a whole bunch of harass.
Lemon very low here. He's flashed a little late on that one to get the flay as well. The first blood actually going to Vile Rose. Very different from the past. And Sneaky forced to flash as well. The Zyra combo definitely not being there this time.
Yeah, a little overconfident here for the duo lane of Cloud9. It looks like the being a little bit rusty on Thresh, you know, he got just a little bit too overconfident. He doesn't have the Stranglethorns or the Grasping Roots of Zyra for the immediate disengage that he could have landed onto both of them.
And you've seen what Balls can do in the bottom lane by himself, as we see Echo very low in mana here, getting attacked. Balls now in a 2v2 situation, can't do anything. He was taking down Dyrus and Odd One in a 2v1, so you can just see the disengage that Zyra does bring to a composition. Maple Street having a great time in that lane due to that setup.
Yeah, I mean, the popularity of the Doran shields in any solo laner who's going up into a 2v1 situation, though, is definitely well-deserved. That item is amazing for the 2v1 lanes because the passive on it blocks so much damage, since you have not only the AD but also the support mainly harassing you with auto attacks.
See where the CS sits at. It's only 33-32, so even though Sneaky's been aggressed and quite hard in lane, he's keeping himself up there. And it doesn't look like either of these towers are going to fall too fast, but if one were to go, it's definitely in favor of Velocity in that bottom lane right now.
And it does look like they have the lead right now, so they are definitely pushing so that they can can avoid that switch I was talking about, where Sneaky and Lemonation finish up their turret and then come down to join a level 6 Rumble for a dragon fight. Because with these two compositions, the first dragon and a level 6 Rumble, it would definitely be in Cloud9's favor.
Not too much action after that first gank. A little bit of aggression by... Top. Oh, again, they get caught out in the top lane. Nice grab there, but the Lantern toss to Lemonation. Cloud9, a few too many mistakes in this top lane.
And there's the benefits of having Thresh, though. The extra escape. Yeah. Since the flash from Sneaky was down from the last time they had, I guess you can call it a lane gank, but it wasn't really a gank because they saw him in lane for so long here. Meteos pretty much doing the same thing. Charging up the Elastic Slingshot from the bush just adds you the extra effect of they don't know when you're coming. And now look at this switch up top. They actually have the Renekton and Jarvan pushing lanes.
Yeah, they have totally turned the table on that top lane. A second Doran's by coming in as well for the Ashe. So Sneaky feeling a bit behind there. Wants some damage. Does get the boots for safety. And again, they try to get to their turret. Now down to half health. The bottom lane engagement here. Again, Meteos tries to go in, but they're pressured off. Cannot continue the engage.
And that's Zyra. She's so good at the disengage, even before she's level 6 and before she has her Stranglethorn's ultimate. The Grasping Roost combo with the seeds, allowing the plants to sprout, just it really deters any harassment from melee champions. So that's why she's so strong in this matchup here.
High calling that Jarvan is middle, and with that pressure still in the bottom lane from Meteos, Vile Rose knows every intent that the team has right now. No existential pressure is going to come onto him. He's still getting pressured out of that lane. 22-23, however, for the CS, as that bottom lane, four Balls, is about to go down. So he's going to get some farm out of this now, but still going to be difficult.
And NK Inc. was just coming not to help take that turret, but just in case Cloud9 were thinking of going aggressive in a last-ditch effort to save it. So now they're actually the ones with vision control of this dragon. And without vision, Cloud9 really don't have an option here.
Yeah, Meteos on the backside, very low, picking up blue for himself. And they're going to be able to take this dragon very nicely here, coming up onto 8 minutes. So we'll see that 14-minute dragon being apparent for these teams, just about 14 minutes as they make it out safely. Vile Rose doing very well in the top lane from past experiences. So that 1-0 for him is going to be good, good, good.
Right now, if I was on velocity, I'd be looking for Echo to be able to shove his lane and go top again. Continue to punish this top lane while the flashes are down, because Lemonations is about to come back up. So if you can keep this Ashe down early and punish them for not having an escape of their own, then they can come back.
A very good call there. The gold card comes out. They have the wardage ready. Oh, no, it gets out. The arrow on the Vile Rose. He should be able to lock up Sneaky before this comes down. Echo's damage is taken away, but they're still going to have enough. Between the two, the Lantern comes out just in time. And it seems like they were just kind of letting each other get the kill.
Such good communication there from Cloud9. When the teleport came in from Twisted Fate, you saw Lemonation immediately flash away. And even though Echo wanted to go after him, he could not because of the flash distance. And so Lemon stays on the outskirts until the very last moment. Sneaky commented that he could use his barrier to stay alive a few more seconds, then throw out the barrier and get, or then throw out the dark passage and get the escape.
So calmly played. Hectic from our vision, but these guys have already placed it out 2 to 3 moves ahead. And just walk out of it calmly. Coming up on to 10 minutes now, it's still that only one kill on the board for Velocity. The turrets have been dropped on either side to make it 1-1, but that first blood and a bit of a CS lead here going to Velocity at about 1,000 gold.
Interesting that they've rotated their duo lane over to mid instead of bot. So Velocity even are calling for the solo of Vile Rose versus boss here.
This is the first time Boss has actually been off the turret. He feels a little bit more confident now having this lane. Sneaky's going to come off behind him, and he's going to switch it back up. It won't stay for the attack. They do not decide to aggress on the bottom lane. No vision onto Jarvan, though, so they got to be careful where NK Inc. is, and maybe that's why they're not going.
Yeah, and Boss can't really add that much tower damage because he is melee, and he would have to get into range of that turret to be able to hurt it. So I think that's a good call for him just backing off. They don't want to overplay their hand right now. And with Jarvan waiting in the wings, it was a really good call for them.
Looks like ADC support mid. Vile Rose grabbed up. Takes a bit of passive damage for actually don't even think she had it up. So just a few auto attacks coming in. Echo to drop this top turret. And Velocity having very good map presence this time around. They really have not lost any of the lanes.
Oh, yeah. When you have Twisted Fate, your map presence definitely pretty strong there. I do like the first Twisted Fate ulti, too, going back to that Destiny. The first Destiny that you pull with a Twisted Fate is very important. And even though he didn't get the kill because he didn't want to flash after Lemonation, it was still the correct call right there.
Putting the fear in the heart of your opponents is really one of the things to do. You don't want them to walk away from the cards. You want them to flash away from it. 11 minutes on the clock so far. And a lot of changeup happening after these first turrets going down. We have the AD carry, like I said, support versus still high in middle, who has not made a move, has not been to other lanes yet. He is continuously firing himself. Do they have the late game team for that?
I really like the mid game strength because of the Rumble Ultimate plus the Slicing Maelstrom there from High. And look at High's build. He's building for that mid-game spike. He's rushing for the Zhonya's. As soon as he's, you know, he only got the one Doran's Blade just for the laning phase, and then he's going right into that Zhonya's because his lane is a Twisted Fate lane, and Twisted Fate is often leaving your lane. So he gets a lot of free farm in that mid lane, and he's not putting it to waste. He's going straight for that power spike. Because once he has that item, their team fight is amazing.
Cloud9 flexing their muscles here in the bottom lane. Vile gonna try to go in and save. He realizes it's very low on the minions. TF coming up on the backside of the lane, but it's still far away. Will it be NK Inc. to hold him up for enough time? He's got a perfect cataclysm. He can throw it down. Flash by Sneaky. TF coming in. Echo finally gets it. He gets hit by the arrow, but gets out the card. Low mana all around here. Meteos trying to get himself into the fight and peel for Sneaky, but I don't know if it's gonna be enough. Goes down. Vile Rose coming up huge in this fight as he initiates it for his team and baits in the rest.
Yeah, I think that Lemon may be a little on tilt for the beginning of this game. And maybe, you know, being not on Zyra, he's getting a little bit too aggressive. We saw both Sneaky and Meteos were pulling back from that because they knew this has got to be a bait. Renekton's not going to dive a solo, but Lemonation threw down all his spells and sort of baited the rest of his team into that fight there while the entire team of Velocity was coming to back up Vile Rose.
And this is huge. Velocity isn't just getting kills. They're getting damage on turrets. They're moving the next chess piece here, and they're really putting everything into position to continuously go for the inhibitors really early.
Yeah, that's definitely a thing that Cloud9 put a lot of importance on. They always say, after a kill, it's all about how you use that time of the person advantage. And Velocity did a good job right there trying to shove in onto the secondary turret, but they weren't able to grab one. So they didn't actually come away with a gold reward. Whereas Balls spent his time free farming up in the top lane. Doing the same thing.
Top lane is actually down to about 280 HP on the turret. So whether this dragon in 40 minutes is lost, they can counter it with that or pick up both if it really happens to crumble in their favor that way. Almost to that dragon time of 14 minutes. The gold lead, 2,000 now in favor of Velocity.
I think this is actually pretty good timing for Velocity. They'd have Rumble shove one more lane up top and then make his way down towards that dragon, because they have a great dragon fighting team, like we said, with the two very strong AoE magic ultimates at this point in the game. When there is no Aegis of the Legion, there is no Bulwark, there's no AoE magic resistance for Velocity, and Cloud9 would love to be able to use those ultimates for a combo right now.
Heaviniscus.
Alls is just too far away, though. He's running
definitely
down.
Definitely positioning a lot better
time
than previous games.
Here.
Keeping them at bay right now. High trying to get himself in for the poke. Great disperse by Velocity. None of them sticking together. None of them staying in any range of an equalizer over everyone or getting hit by that maelstrom. So they're ready.
So people at home, if you're wondering why Velocity didn't rush for that dragon, it's because they had no vision of Balls. Even though Balls was just walking down the river, they didn't have vision of it, so they didn't know that he was that far away.
Oh, this could be bad. The Equalizer will be able to go across the front.
Oh,
they lay
God.
It down into three members. The Slicing Maelstrom to follow. They thought they could get the dragon, but it cost them their lives.
Yeah, they went back in for it. You always have a free engage with the Ash Arrow. Very good job by Cloud9. And Balls is not done. Or High's not done.
Cloud9 is known to be a team to fight, and that's what they wanted. Like you said, High hadn't left his lane. This is what he wanted to leave it for. They're able to grab Dragon and make it out, evening that up at 1-1 on Dragons. We're going to see the next one around 20 minutes here, but 4-3 now. It was 3-0.
Yeah, Cloud9, they did a perfect job of throwing out the Shurikens from High there just to stall Velocity on the dragon and wait until Balls could join them, because their composition is built for this time of the game. It's built for these dragon fights. Cloud9 would love to take that fight. They've got the guaranteed engage of the Crystal Arrow from Ashe, and you can easily follow that up with the AoE combo that we just saw them pull off.
It's so scary to go after something like that when the other team wants you to just choke up around something. Mm-hmm. They say thank you to Dragon, take it up, and now defend their mid lane. Velocity still showing strength, though. They know they've been having a good game. They know the gold still has to be close even after that scuffle. And looks like they still try to pressure up.
So what they wanted there was another engage from Cloud9 so that they could take advantage of the fact that all the cooldowns were blown in that last fight. But Cloud9, they know that they don't want to fight without that AoE combo. And so they just hit under their turret, stalled it out, and now they're going to have the advantage in the team fights once again because the ultis are coming off cooldown.
They'll be able to pressure this quite hard. Looking at their team now, a pretty good amount of siege clear there, but unless they have Zyra, then that turret's going to take quite a bit of damage each time they get up. So Cloud9, once they start to put that pressure on, it's going to be never-ending.
Yeah, so what Velocity need to do to counter this giant team fight that Cloud9 have.
Oh, he dodged it with the Cataclysm, jumps over the arrow. High throws down the Zhonya's as he puts on Maelstrom. Pop back across, and it looks like Velocity is way too split for this flight. There's four members, five members now of Cloud9 in the middle. Can Maple Street get the damage down? He's walking up too close to the fight. He may have misclicked there, but he looks like he can get himself out. One harpoon hits, the second to follow up. The death of Maple Street, buff transfer complete, and now 8-4 in favor of Cloud9.
That's why you have to keep track of those cooldowns that I was talking about. I said as soon as Cloud9 get their ultis back up, they're going to just continue with the exact same story. They want team fight after team fight because of the guaranteed engage followed up by AoE right there. And I was about to say Velocity need to just wave clear and split push because they have the TF. They have the mobility advantage. They don't want those team fights, but it's very hard to avoid a team fight when the other team has Ashe.
Even when you miss the Ash Arrow and you're engaging under your own turret, for them to have or miss that initiation and still win the fight is not spelling good things for Velocity here. They have to take these things into consideration and really position these fights out. Not a lot of the crowd control from Heaviniscus was used, which has really gotten them all the kills that are on the chart so far. So hopefully we'll find it next time. Cloud9 looking for a repeat session of that last fight, though. Coming up now, 18 minutes. They're spreading their gold lead to 3,500, and they've picked up two turrets in the meantime.
So even though the Crystal Arrow misses, it's still a zoning tool. They make velocity split apart for the team fight there, and they're not together for the disengage. And Cloud9 have a secondary engage that is Zac. It's that Meteos who's so tanky always, and he loves being the first one to get in there because of that Cell Division passive, and because he just builds straight tank. He is a damage sponge.
All right, Kobe, we're 18 and a half in. Let's take stock of the inventories. A 4-0 and 4 balls on Rumble. 1-0 and 6 for Meteos. 0-2 and 5 on Sneaky, who's been pressured, but the team is able to pick it up around. And another thing that contributes to Meteos' farm is he's able to do that if Sneaky can't. So these guys are definitely synergizing, always in their gameplay, to help each other out if one's behind.
That's one of the things that definitely sets Cloud9 apart from a lot of the other North American teams, is the fact that Sneaky does not prioritize farming up as much as he does prioritize pushing objectives. Usually the AD carries on many of these teams prioritize their own farm even above global objectives. But you can see there, Cloud9 called for a grouping for a second team fight, and he came right over. The Crystal Arrow, even though he doesn't hit, is a crucial part to their strategy.
Seeing what kind of aggression they can put on this turret as we see balls coming around from the side, trying to get that Rumble ulti in from the Fog of War. He will be chased by Vile Rose, so they don't have everybody here to guard, but they also don't have a minion wave to push just yet. Mm-hmm. They have to worry about Echo in the bottom lane, so they trying to keep that multitask mentality going on the side of Velocity.
Yeah, Velocity's trying to do what
The arrow hits this time! That is the detriment of it as well. They throw down the Slicing Maelstrom. High still has the Zhonya's to be used, but he just kind of walks it around, and they have full control of the fight. Echo to push bottom.
The reason that Cloud9 don't hesitate and they use everything, just flashing in and popping all the ultimates, is because Twisted Fate does not have a true global ultimate. He couldn't have actually gotten all the way back to that turret. It's only about half a map there, and since he was so far in the bottom lane, Cloud9 take the easy 4-5.
Two members of Velocity plus the inhibitor turret, which means that front door... Oh, they didn't get it!
Meteos,
one more shot. Meteos goes in and blobs the turret, gets it to go down. They're going to walk out of this one with an easy Ash Volley bat. Wait a minute. She's out of mana here, and here comes Echo. Echo throwing himself in a little hot in the frying pan here. NK Inc. goes in. The ignites down the shot from Sneaky with the last bit of mana on the Frost Arrow. They continue on to Echo. Eyes now into Vile Rose, and this may have been a bad situation. A good one turning sour. The Wild Growth to stop, not Wild Growth, throwing down Zyra's ultimate to lock them down.
Strangle thorns.
Get quick shot back up here.
So that right there was Velocity trying to take advantage of Echo's positioning, but since the rest of Velocity did not have good positioning to follow up on that, it was a really poor flanking maneuver there, and they should have actually just let Cloud9 go back to their base, because as you can see, they're no match 3-5, even when Cloud9 are low health.
So after that one fight of Cloud9 at the Dragon, they pretty much shown that the muscles can be flexed just about anywhere under any turret and under any circumstance. So at 12-5, increasing that gold lead now to 6,200 gold, just about 7,000 if they reach another 500 real quick. But it looks like High is going to stop farming. Maple Street will try to get himself in. Like we said, that CS is in his favor because of the way Sneaky plays, but that's not the impact damage. He's that AD caster, so he's looking for those cooldowns to get damage from afar in the fights. Sneaky's been just throwing out the damage and staying till his last bit of 100 HP.
Exactly. When the rest of your team is so aggressive and all concentrated on diving Velocity, and Velocity have to be on the back foot, it frees up a normally unsafe AD carry in Ashe to be just continually flying and always getting off his auto attacks here. That's why it makes Sneaky's job a lot easier for him, because Cloud9 are running this full-in AoE composition.
Let's see what they're taking here. Maybe coming in with an Abyssal Scepter. No, not an Abyssal Scepter.
Yeah, so are you talking about Cloud9 here? Cloud9 are continuing to build for team fights. So they're adding on to their amazing composition by splitting up the duties of the auras here. The Abyssal Scepter is key to the balls and Kennen combo because you're lowering the magic resist. And then balls, it frees him up to go with the Rylai's press, the Lissandries, which is going to have that burn.
And you can see the consideration being taken. Vile Rose picking up that Negatron cloak for himself as well in the build. As they go up here, Cloud9 looking to go for Baron. They do have Echo just above them, which may be going down unless they decide to go for one of these lanes. The bottom lane is going to be pushed. Once this Baron is down, the map is objective free. That would be a place for them to head.
Velocity need to make their move now. They're in position to pull the pincer.
There's the Baron going down. This is going to be even harder for the Fire. Rose gets hit right in the kisser. He's going to be diving into the fight. He has to do what he can. Going down valiantly for his team. They're going to be able to get out and set up some D.
That is the danger of going to try and contest Baron, but not going all in. If you wait until Cloud9 have just finished the Baron, and they're all now wearing the buff and not taking damage from Baron anymore, then the exact same team fight is going to happen. That's already happened twice in this game.
There's a team fight, and then there's a team fight with hard mode, and that's the hard mode. An NT there, if you will. Nice try coming in. Vile Rose getting caught out by the Enchanted Crystal Arrow, but the team was able to get to safety, and they should be able to guard pretty much the inhibitor. They may see the turret go down, though, with such a wave pouring down the mid lane.
This Cloud9 fascination with Ashe reminds me so much of the very early Season 1, where the top AD carry, it was all about Ashe because of the Crystal Arrow, and everyone put so much value on that late-game engage. But because of all the new AD carries that came out, she kind of fell behind.
Oh, going in! The Cataclysm goes down, but it kind of locks up Meteos to just hit everybody inside of that, hurting themselves a little bit there. Echo throwing back an Elimination. He's hardly taking any damage. The turret getting tanked out easily, and they push Velocity back to the fountain.
And it looks like they're not done. They're just going to take this inhibitor and roll on Nexus turrets.
They have more coming down. They have a full wave, not super minions in the bottom lane, but they do have super minions to work with in the mid. It looks like they are going to take a break here. The home guards could make things a little sticky, and they're not going to take that chance.
Yeah, just kidding. Even though it is 5-on-3 with Baron buff, you've got two inhibitors down.
Yeah.
And there's nothing on the map for Velocity to take. So really, Velocity right now are just sitting on death row, waiting for the sentence to come through from Cloud9.
Cloud9 coming back out of base. Full bore on this one. Not even really enough time in this game for third core items to come out. We do have the Ancient Golem onto the jungler with the Bulwark, or Meteos rather, with the Bulwark. There's two. Abyssal Scepter, Zhonya's, there's two. Even on Velocity, they have those two items. But it's the fighting, again, from Cloud9 that's just so accurate and so on point every time that allows them to win. Well, they're not even, but even under the circumstances.
It's definitely not only the gold advantage that's allowed Cloud9 to buy all those items, but also the core composition that's all focused around this team fighting that really leaves Velocity with nowhere else to go. They can have Twisted Fate holding Superman in waves, but he can't even split push at this point. He has to stay close enough to be able to Destiny to the rest of his team, or else they just have no hope.
See what they can do to clear these waves out. Evaniscus trying to keep vision on them so they don't get engaged in some unorthodox way. Lemonation looking to make that happen himself. We'll see how this wave clear goes. There's not enough there. They decide to go on the first wave that was there. The turret not even taking damage. NK Inc. can't even get out. Tries the Cataclysm to put down the last bit of DPS, but it's not going to happen. Double kill for High as they turn their eyes to the Nexus turret, or the Inhibitor turrets, and maybe the Nexus turrets.
Very nice Crystal Arrow there. If Ash hits a Crystal Arrow on anyone for Velocity, they go. But if you hit it onto Maple Street, the highest priority target, then that's a guaranteed dive in.
That's high octane engagement right there. When you got the AD carry with an Enchanted Crystal Arrow, first game of the day, looking great for Velocity in the beginning, but Cloud9 was able to find a dragon fight to pull themselves back around and climb the hill to victory. The Nexus goes down, and Cloud9 stays at the top.
Congratulations to Cloud9. They just boosted their stat a little bit. They already had the highest KDA as a team.